Hello everyone, welcome in the class of physiology. In previous class we have learned about the digestive tract wall, their structure and the regulation of digestive process. So in this class we will discuss about the mouth, buccal cavity or oral cavity. It is the first part of the digestive tract and it is adapted to receive food by the ingestion, break it into the small particle by mastication and mix it with the saliva. The lips, cheeks and palate form the boundaries and the oral cavity contain the teeth and tongue and receive the secretion from the salivary glands. So we will learn about buccal cavity in this lecture. So in this class the topic will be covered: the oral cavity, tonsil, teeth, saliva, salivary secretions, salivary reflex and the digestion in the mouth. So let's start with the oral cavity. It is also called buccal cavity. A human oral cavity has upper lips, lower lips and superior labial frenulum, inferior labial frenulum and lingual frenulum. It also has hard palate as well as soft palate. The soft palate is associated with the uvula. The oral cavity or mouth is the entrance to the digestive tract. The opening is formed by the muscular lips which help procure, guide and contain the food in the mouth. Lips also serve the non-digestive functions like speech organization and it has the sensory receptor that help for the making interpersonal relationship like kissing. The palate, which forms the arched roof of the oral cavity, it separates the mouth from the nasal cavity. So it presents allow breathing and chewing or sucking to take place simultaneously. The uvula is hanging down from the soft palate. It plays important role in closing of the nasal passage during swallowing process. The tongue, which forms the roofs of the oral cavity, is composed of voluntarily controlled skeletal muscles. The movement of the tongue are important in guiding food within the mouth during chewing and swallowing and also play an important role in the speech organization. So furthermore, the major taste buds are also located on the tongue. So the tongue is a muscular organ in the mouth and it is covered with the moist pink tissue called mucosa. The taste bud is located primarily along the edges of the papillae on the upper surface of the tongue and provide the tongue its rough texture. There are thousands of the taste bud cover the surface of the papillae. So the taste buds are collection of nerve-like cells that connect to the nerves running into the brain. In the back of the mouth, the tongue is anchored into the hyoid bone. The tongue is vital for the chewing and swallowing the food as well as for the speech. So we can discriminate among thousands of different tastes sensations. So yet all the tastes are varying combination of five primarily tastes, that is salty, sour, sweet, bitter and umami. And umami is a meaty like taste and has recently been added to the list of primary tastes that result from the testing glutamate. Actually, This is present in flavor additive monosodium glutamate that is also called MSG. It is primarily used in Asian country food market. So the tongue has many nerves that help detect and transmit taste signal to the brain. Because of this, all part of the tongue can detect this common taste. So there are nothing is like taste mapping. Now see this picture for the better understanding of the upper digestive tract. This one is nasal cavity, and below the nasal cavity, hard palate is present. The end of the hard palate is a soft palate, and down to the soft palate is uvula. In the buccal cavity, the tongue is present, and this one is epiglottis. This one is a voice box or larynx, and this one is trachea, and this one is oesophagus. Now the pharynx is the cavity at the rear of the throat, and it act as a common passageway for the digestive system by serving as a link between the mouth and oesophagus for the food, as well as the respiratory system by providing access between the nasal passage and the trachea for the air. So the nasopharynx is depicted in the green color, and it receives air from the nasal cavity. The oropharynx received food from the buccal cavity, and the hypopharynx is a common passageway for the air and the food. So from the hypopharynx there are two passageways, that is trachea and the oesophagus. So now we will learn about the tonsils. So tonsils are lymphoid organ and a small organ in the back of the throat. So as a part of the lymphatic system, they play an important role in the health of the body. So technically there are three set of the tonsil in the body, that is pharyngeal tonsil, which is known as adenoids, the palatine tonsil, and the lingual tonsil, which are lymphatic tissue on the surface tissue of the base of the tongue. So the tonsil prevent foreign object from the slipping into the lungs, and they also filter bacteria and viruses. On the top of all that, they produce white blood cells and the antibodies. So here we can see that this is the structure of the normal tonsil, and this is the structure of the inflamed tonsils. So this is the location of the pharyngeal tonsil. You can see here the palatine tonsil is located here, and the lingual tonsil is present here. So the first step in the digestive process is mastication or chewing, that is the motility of the mouth that involve the slicing, tearing, grinding and mixing of the ingested food by the teeth. So now we will learn about the teeth. So here we can see the structure of the teeth. A teeth has three parts. The upper part is called crown, the middle part is called neck, and the lower part is called root. A teeth has hardest part, upper surface enamel, and this enamel forms before the tooth's eruption by the special cell that are lost as a tooth erupts. Below the enamel, the dentine is present, and below the dentine there is pulp cavity. This pulp cavity has nerves and blood vessels, and the teeth are firmly embedded in and protrude from the jaw bones. So this one is the jaw bones that fix the tooth or teeth with the help of cement, and the upper portion of the jawbone is covered with the gum tissue. Each tooth is embedded in a socket of the jawbone, as we have seen in previous slide, and this type of attachment is called thecodont. So majority of the mammal, including human being, form two set of the teeth during their life. So a set of temporary milk or deciduous teeth replaced by a set of permanent or adult teeth. So this type of dentition is called diphyodont. In an adult human that has 32 permanent teeth, which are of four different type, it is also called heterodont dentition system. And these four different type of the teeth is called incisor, canine, also called cuspid, premolar, and molar. The arrangement of the teeth in each half of the upper and lower jaw in the order incisor, canine, premolar, and molar is represented by a dental formula in the human is 2:1:2, 2:3. So we have learned about the tooth or teeth. Now we will learn about the saliva. The saliva is the secretion associated with the mouth and is produced largely by three major pair of the salivary glands that lie outside of the oral cavity and discharge saliva through short duct into the mouth. So in this figure we can see that there are three pair of salivary gland, that is parotid gland, the submandibular gland, and the sublingual gland. So the saliva is about 99.5% water and 0.5% electrolyte and proteins. So the salivary NaCl or salt concentration is only 1/7 of that in the plasma, which is important in perceiving salty tastes. Similarly, discrimination of sweet taste is enhanced by the absence of glucose in the saliva. The most important salivary protein are amylase, mucus, and lysozyme. Saliva begin carbohydrate digestion is important in oral hygiene and facilitate the speech process. So saliva begin digestion of the carbohydrate in the mouth through action of salivary amylase. Salivary amylase is an enzyme that breaks polysaccharide molecules into the maltose, a disaccharide consisting of two glucose molecules. So saliva facilitates swallowing by the moistening food particles, thereby holding them together, and by providing lubrications through the presence of mucus, which is a thick and slippery. The saliva exerts some antibacterial action by a fourfold effect, first by the lysozyme, an enzyme that lyse or destroy the certain bacteria by breaking down the cell wall. Second, by the binding of the glycoprotein that bind IgA antibody. And third, by the lactoferrin, which tightly bind to the iron needed for the bacterial multiplication. And fourth fold, by the rising away material that may serve as a food source for the bacteria. So saliva aid speech by facilitating movement of the lips and tongue. It is difficult to talk when your mouth feels dry. Now we will look another function of the saliva. So actually saliva serve as a solvent for the molecule that stimulate the taste buds. Actually only molecule in the solution can react with the taste bud receptor. So you can do an experiment by yourself. You have to dry your tongue with some cotton, and then you should drop some sugar on your tongue. So you will not taste the sugar until your tongue is moist. So the flow of saliva also flushes away the food particle on taste bud so that you can taste the next bite of the food. So saliva play an important role in oral hygiene as well by helping keep the mouth and teeth clean. The constant flow of the saliva secretion helps flush away the food residue, foreign particles and old epithelial cells that have seeded from the oral mucosa. The saliva contribution in this regard is apparent to anyone who has experienced a foul taste in the mouth when salivation is suppressed by a while, such as during a fever or state of the prolonged anxiety during your presentation also. So saliva enrich in bicarbonate buffers which neutralize acid in the food as well as acid produced by the bacteria in the mouth, so thereby helping prevent dental caries. So we have understand the functions of the saliva, which is very important for the taste as well as for the mastication process. Now we will understand about the salivary secretions. So on average, about 1 to 2 liters of the saliva are secreted per day, ranging from a continuous spontaneous basal rate of 0.5 ml per minute to a maximum flow rate about 5 ml per minute in response to a potent stimulus such as sucking on a lemon. So the continuous basal secretion of the saliva in the absence of apparent stimuli is brought about by the constant low level stimulation by the parasympathetic nerve ending that terminate in the salivary glands. So this basal secretion is important in keeping the mouth and throat moist at all time. So in addition to this, continuous low level secretion, salivary secretion may be increased by two types of the salivary reflex, the simple and conditioned salivary reflexes. Now we will understand about the salivary reflex pathway. Actually, salivary secretion may be increased by the two steps of the salivary reflexes, that is the simple salivary reflexes and the conditioned or acquired salivary reflexes. The simple salivary reflex occurs when the chemoreceptor and pressure receptor within the oral cavity respond to the presence of the food. So when we eat the food, the pressure receptor and the chemoreceptor which is present in our buccal cavity that stimulate the salivary center present in the medulla, resulting that stimulate the autonomic nerves and it lead to the stimulation of the salivary secretion to secrete the saliva. The conditioned or acquired salivary reflex occurred without oral stimulation. So when you just think about seeing or smell or you just hear about the pleasant food, that initiate the saliva through this reflex. So actually when you see, smell or hear the preparation of the pleasant food, that input the stimulate the cerebral cortex, and this stimulation can stimulate the salivary center that is present in the medulla, and it stimulate the autonomic nerves and it stimulate the salivary gland to produce a large amount of the saliva. Now we will see the digestion in the mouth. So digestion in the mouth involves the hydrolysis of polysaccharide molecule into the disaccharide molecule by amylase, which is present in the salivary secretions. So however, most digestion by this enzyme is accomplished in the body of the stomach after the food mass and saliva have been swallowed. So acid inactivate this enzyme, but in the center of the food mass where stomach acid has not yet reached, this salivary amylase continue to function for the several more hours. So there are no absorption of the food stuff occur from the mouth, but some drug can be absorbed by the oral mucosa. For example, nitroglycerin. The nitroglycerin is a vasodilator drug which is prescribed by the doctor to the cardiac patient to relieve the anginal attack associated with the myocardial ischemia. Now I am ending the session, and we have learned in this session about the oral cavity, the tonsils, types of the tonsils, the teeth, the dentition system, the saliva, saliva secretion, its composition, and the reflex pathway of the salivary secretions, as well as digestion in the mouth. So now this is the question session, and I am giving you some question for your homework. You have to discuss the different types of the tonsil. You should write the answer for this question, that is the explain the salivary reflex. You have to explain the salivary reflex, how salivary secretion is controlled by the nervous stimulation, and you have to describe the control of the salivary secretions. You should elaborate the structure of the teeth, how human teeth is differ with the other animal teeth. You should learn about this. So these are the reference book which is listed here. You can go with any of this book for the better understanding of the human physiology and medical physiology. So now I am closing this session, and I am requesting you all to join our next lecture that will be based on the pharynx, oesophagus and stomach. So thank you all for listening me. Thank you.